5 plus years ago, it was all women in the audience, and it was all women reading. And my Facebook friend was Tom Bergeron, and he had a book about to drop. And he said, what if I wear a dress? And I said, well, you know, I made the rules. I can fucking break them. Mm-hmm. So I reached out also on Facebook to Evan Handler. Mm-hmm. And Ron Zimmerman was here that day, too. Well, it was the first time women who write welcomed men. And it was, I don't think anybody in this room was here that day, right? Were you?
Yeah.
You were?
Yeah.
Wow! Oh my God. How amazing was that day?
Amazing.
And Tom Bergeron did the R-rated version, which you just don't get to hear him do that very often. But what really blew my mind that day was Evan. Evan's done, I believe, 8 Broadway shows. He stood up at this, I don't even know, did I have a podium? I think I had the same podium. My TV tray in my head. And, don't break the illusion. And he did my living room as if he was at the Neil Simon Theater in New York. Blew our collective, it was absolutely extraordinary. And so some months ago, I sold my first piece to a magazine. Called Reimagine, which is, I got goaded into doing it, thank God. And they wanted a celebrity interview, and actually somebody else wanted me to introduce them, and I said, no, I'll only bring it if I can write it. And Evan was gracious enough, he's going to tell you his story, but he was gracious enough to grant me an interview, and for an hour and a half, I got the best stories. I don't know what he's going to share with us today, what he's going to I know he's not reading from this, but I thought he was, and I'm excited because he read to us from his second book, It's Only Temporary, The Good News and Bad News of Being Alive. But today he's going to read to us from his first book, which I'm really excited to hear. But anyway, it was an extraordinary reading. He is an extraordinary, he is the most intense, I don't mean to give myself kudos, but you know, I'm kind of intense. Evan is like me to the 10th power. He is so intense, so passionate, so, oh God. Anyway, you're in for a treat, I'm excited. Okay, he's best known for playing Harry Goldenblatt, which Harry, my son, yeah, so right away I'm there, on Sex and the City, those of you who know that, and Californication, which I'm so excited, and Rumpel's coming back, Californication's coming back in January, which is now the launch of the magazine, so it's going to be a perfect timing, which I'm really excited about. Evan's played leading roles in ABC, It's Like You Know, which my stylist, Craig Ames, was the stylist in Dressed Evan. He dressed you, I just found that, I didn't even know that. Okay.
He dressed me this morning.
He did. Traitor! He was on NBC Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip.
Oh,
such a great show. He has made numerous memorable guest appearances on Lost, The West Wing, 6 Feet Under, Necessary Roughness, and Friends. And in 2000, Evan played Larry Fine in the ABC TV movie, The Three Stooges. On the big screen, Evan has played leading roles in Ron Howard's Ransom, starring Mel Gibson, and featured in leading roles in Oliver Stone's Natural Born Killers, and Taps, where it started, The Chosen, and Sweet Lorraine. Prior to his film and television work, Evan earned acclaim in 7 Broadway productions, all performed prior to his 30th birthday.
Oh.
Which includes
and
six.
Nonsense.
which includes 6 Degrees of Separation, I Hate Hamlet, and there's a story with that, Brighton Beach Memoirs, Broadway Bound, and Master Harold and the Boys. Evan is also the author of these 2 books. His first one, Time on Fire, My Comedy of Terrors, is the one we're going to hear from today. I cannot wait. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome. I am so grateful, so honored to have him back in the living room.
Thank you, everybody. Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
There's a compartment.
Yeah.
I feel humbled in the presence of the other talents that are here today. And I get the sense there are a lot of powerful personalities in the room. I did come here 5 years ago. I read from It's Only Temporary, The Good News and the Bad News of Being Alive. I chose not to read from it today because I thought there'd be a lot of people who heard those stories already. I am the author of two books. This one, Time on Fire, it tells the story of how I managed to survive and get well from a supposedly unsurvivable illness in the mid-1980s, diagnosed when I was 24 years old with acute myeloid leukemia, considered to be incurable at that time. This book tells how I never got over the things that happened in this book. to put it briefly. That's not exactly true. It tells how long it took for me, I suppose, to be able to experience gratitude in the life I knew I was lucky just to be living. I think that's about the introduction that's necessary. Well, this one, this is the better book, I think. this one was written with a greater degree of difficulty. It has an unusual structure to tell a story. And it's filled with tales of sex and failed romance, ultimately culminating in a late but successful marriage and birth of a child, whose existence actually turns out to be statistically less likely than my own. So it's rather miraculous stories in there in addition to in here. But I'm going to read today from Time on Fire. These are events that happened a long time ago, which is something I never thought I'd be able to say. And I think that's probably about what you need to know. It is... it takes place somewhat late in the book, and it's a culmination of outrage. I went through that illness with tremendous anger, rage, and came out of it for years afterwards feeling that way because I felt that everything that happened to me, I mean, how do you make an incurable illness more difficult to survive than necessary? And that's, I experienced a lot of that. And then a lot of extra anger and retribution when I tried to question the ways that things might be made easier for me. Now, there is one female figure, since I'm in a room of mostly females, who's dealt with harshly in this story, but I can assure you, that male medical professionals are dealt with just as harshly. okay, so this is a chapter called "Crying Job's Tears," so it's rather the down part of the book. My new roommate was a man named, if you can believe it, Willie Dingle. The first time I heard it, I thought as far as his grade school existence must have gone, his parents might as well have named him Penis Penis. Willie was somewhere close to my age. He was a nice, friendly guy. But he was not doing well at all. He'd already had a bone marrow transplant, the procedure I was working my way toward. But Willie was not recovering properly. He was suffering from just about every complication one could hope to avoid, short of actually up and dying altogether. Willie's hands and arms were wrapped in loose bandages, covering the sore, swollen tracks left by the endless attempts to locate his scarred veins. And he was constantly receiving some kind of blood transfusion. No matter how many platelets they pumped into poor Willie Dingle, his blood counts remained the same. No matter how many units of packed red cells they slipped under his skin, his body just burned them up without making use of them. As a result, one or the other of Willie's eyes was always stained an ugly bloody red from a burst blood vessel. As soon as one eye would heal, the other would spring a leak. With the bandages on his arms, his weary, plodding walk, and blood running out of his eyes, Willie looked like a full-color version of one of the zombies from Night of the Living Dead. As a precautionary measure, the nursing staff had consigned Willie to strict bed rest. The platelet problem put him in extreme danger of hemorrhaging from the slightest bump or bruise. Regardless of the facts, every day Willie would get up to go for a walk and quickly be led back to his bed by a scolding, soft-voiced nurse's aide. Now, you know you're not supposed to be out of bed, Willie. If you fall down or bump yourself, there ain't not one thing we're going to be able to do for you. It never stopped Willie, though. If you couldn't walk the halls, he'd wander around the room. I'd watch Willie round the corner of my curtain, making the way toward the bathroom we shared. He'd lean heavily on his IV pole for support, sometimes stopping mysteriously to rest or just stand and think somewhere along the 11-step expedition. Whenever Willie parked himself near the foot of my bed or stood staring wistfully out the window in the dead center of my line of sight, the silence in the room grew too real to tolerate. "Hey, Willie," I'd say, just to be saying something. "How's it going?" Willie would snap out of his trance, always looking surprised to remember where he was and that there was someone else there with him. Then he'd slowly drawl, his tired voice still stuck in whatever faraway place the rest of him had just returned from. "Oh, you know," and he'd start back on his way, refreshed for the final leg of his journey across the barren desert of our semi-private, whatever that means, hospital room. That was pretty much the extent of our communication, Willie and I, day after day, and sometimes several times within one. "Hey, Willie, how's it going?" "Oh, you know." Not that there wasn't variation within the theme. Even without any other words than those, there's a respect and an intimacy that develops between people sharing in each other's illness and experiencing the looming possibility of each other's death. Willie and I never exchanged stories. We never gave each other a rundown of our personal histories. We never complained to or relied on each other. We overheard and we witnessed all of the very worst things that could possibly be happening to the other one. And once or twice a day, I would say, "Hey, Willie, how's it going?" And Willie would say, "Oh, you know." The doctors made their bedside visits at the crack of dawn. In the spooky illumination just beginning to seep through the window, the clomp of three pairs of shoes would penetrate my sleep just before the lights would snap on. The timing of the visits, I'm sure, was decided on for reasons no more malicious than efficient scheduling, but I couldn't help suspecting that on some level, the doctors were glad to visit the patients when they were still asleep. The better to find them docile and undemanding, the better to drop their bombshells and make a quick getaway. Early one morning, before the sun had even begun to rise, Willie was visited by one young female doctor traveling alone. She padded around my bed, pulling the curtain to make an even tighter enclosure to seal me off from the other half of the room. She spoke to Willie without turning on the light. The doctor's voice was as hard and sharp as the floor tile in the pre-dawn room. Her heavy suburban New Jersey accent was knocked off kilter by an insistently sing-song perkiness and cheerful over-enunciation she tried to inject into every sentence. The attempt was unfortunate. Instead of making her seem friendly, she only sounded bored. Instead of compensating for a lack of intelligence on her patient's part, she only called into question her own. "Good morning, Mr. Dingle. How are you today?" That question always got me. I never knew how to answer it myself at 5 a.m. after being woken from a drug-induced sleep that I might have fallen into only a few hours before. The doctor plowed on. "Mr. Dingle, I'm Donna, Dr. G's new fellow. We met yesterday, remember?" I heard Willie whine. I didn't think he was even awake. "Mr. Dingle, remember the CAT scan we took yesterday?" Willie's whine had tightened into a pleading whimper. It was the sound of someone fighting to stay hidden under the covers on a frigid morning, safe from the cold and safe in sleep from life and its infinite indignities. "The pictures, Mr. Dingle, with the machine of your head. Remember the pictures we took, Mr. Dingle, of your head?" I heard Willie make the sound again, but this time it was a surrender, a reluctant acceptance of the inevitability of whatever might be waiting for him. "Well, Mr. Dingle, there was a mass, okay? The pictures showed you have a mass. So we can't give you any more treatment until we find out what it is, okay? Mr. Dingle, the pictures showed you have a mass." The way she said the word mass made me dig into my mattress with my fingernails. She honked the word out with a harsh, compressed nasality that threatened to shatter the window panes and light bulbs in the room. I heard Willie move in his bed. I couldn't tell if he was sitting up to pay more attention or pulling the pillow over his head, trying to pretend this woman was just a monster in some bad dream. "Mr. Dingle, I have a form here for you to sign. Since you have a mass, Mr. Dingle, I need you to sign this form for us. Do you understand? The form tells us what to do if you become incapacitated, okay? Do you understand, Mr. Dingle? The form tells us what to do if you become incapacitated. The form tells us if you want us to take extraordinary measures to resuscitate you if you become incapacitated." The word incapacitated had lost all its meaning for me. She said it so many times in such a brief span that it had become nothing more than a chunk of six-syllable gibberish. I assumed that Willie was at least nodding his head, because then the doctor said, "Good, Mr. Dingle. I'll leave the form here so you can talk it over with your family, okay? We can come pick it up later." Then, in a remarkable and rare display of compassion, she lowered her voice and she said, "I know this is hard, Mr. Dingle. It's a difficult decision." She turned from his bed and started walking around the curtain past me toward the door. Striding by, as if she just couldn't release herself from the last line of the pathetically predictable script, she called back, "Have a good day, Mr. Dingle." I wanted to leap out of the bed and tackle her. I wanted to grab her by the neck and strangle her. I wanted to say, "You fucking bitch. How dare you? How dare you wake this man up at 5 o'clock in the morning to give him news like that? 5 hours before any visitors are even allowed on the floor to see him. And who do you think you're talking to anyway? That's Willie Dingle over there. Willie Dingle doesn't even know what a mass is. He doesn't know extraordinary measures or resuscitate. He sure doesn't know what incapacitated means even before you hypnotized him with the word. And worse than any of that, who do you think you are, telling him all that horrible, gruesome shit right here in the room where I have to listen to it too? You think I don't have problems of my own I have to worry about? You think I need to be here when Willie Dingle hears he hasn't got a prayer left in this world, and that no one's heard any of his prayers so far anyway?" I wanted to kill this doctor for her stupidity, for her insensitivity, and her complicity in the conspiracy that had trapped me there. And I wanted to kill her for nothing more than being the messenger who had brought the bad news. She smiled at me as she left the room and faded away down the hall. I watched her go and didn't say a word. I learned that I'd been wrong about my neighbor Willie and about what he could and couldn't understand. As the first rays of light squeezed through the break in the curtains, in the silence of the aftermath of the attack, I lay still in my bed and I listened to Willie Dingle cry. The next day, I moved myself into a private room. The cost was $150 a day above what my insurance would pay for. I never asked about Willie Dingle again, and I did my best to avoid even going back down to that end of the floor. Besides the arguable insanity of placing one patient preparing for a bone marrow transplant in a room with another patient suffering from all of the procedure's worst complications, I just couldn't bear to be around any more grief than my own life contained already. Several months later, on one of my last visits to the outpatient clinic of Sloan Kettering, I was walking past the open door of the blood lab. I was thinking what a waste of humanity that hospital made me feel. Sick people, packed like rats, lined up to receive their painful procedures, all hoping that it might pay off someday when they would run far away and try to forget it ever happened. I heard the bell ring and sped my steps to cram myself into the overstuffed elevator, when out of the corner of my eye I saw a familiar face sitting in the chair of the blood lab 20 feet away. "Jesus," I thought. "Jesus Christ, it's Willie. Willie Dingle." I couldn't believe that Willie Dingle had made it out of the hospital. Just then Willie caught my eye and he smiled. His eyes were clear and his teeth flashed a healthy bright white against his dark skin. He looked good. I forgot about the elevator and took a couple of steps closer and we waved. I stood staring at him just outside the door in the hustle and the bustle of the crowd. I chuckled to myself at the memory of our cryptic, monosyllabic communication some months before. Every morning, the same lines. "Hey, Willie, how's it going?" Willie's inevitable response had since become a favorite of my own. When friends or relatives would call on the phone to ask me how I was feeling, I'd get a private laugh out of adopting Willie's exhausted expression. "Oh, you know." I was nearly knocked over by a man on crutches who had bandages wrapped around his head. I caught my balance and saw Willie laughing at me as the blood lab technician jabbed a needle into the crook of his arm. "Hey," I said, grinning at him like a dope. "Hey, Willie, how's it going?" Willie smiled a little wider. His expression was much more sly than I'd ever noticed before. He was wearing black stonewashed jeans and a neon blue shirt and brand new Air Jordan sneakers. I realized I'd never seen him wearing clothes before. Nothing but a hospital gown. Willie sat looking up at me. He took a long, deep breath, and he said, "Oh, I'm pretty good, man. How about yourself?" This might or might not be what I read here 5 years ago. I don't know.
Well, it's just me and Suzanne, so.
This is called Italian Dreaming. When I was first shown the collection of buildings my father-in-law owns in Molinella, a small town in northern Italy, I immediately began calculating how much longer he might live. The buildings are not luxurious. Two of the three are what the family call factories, but they're really just large rectangular brick and concrete shells. The interiors resemble nothing so much as enormous garages. One of the factories has a couple of modest apartments attached. Inside one of those apartments is where my wife did most of her growing up. The third building is in town and has two floors. Downstairs is another garage and an unfinished rental space that currently houses a local community center. Upstairs is another apartment, and that's where my wife lived. That's where my wife lived with her parents and her grandmother until she was 9 when they moved to the factory 1/2 kilometer away. The apartment in town is also where her father was born. Shortly after her grandmother's death, 27 years after they'd left, Elisa's parents moved back to the apartment in town. People don't move very much or very far in Italy. In my father-in-law's case, they don't move very much or very far, then as soon as possible, they move right back where they started. Since my father-in-law was only 65 at the time of my first visit, and since his own mother had lived to 92, things weren't looking immediately promising in terms of my wife's inheritance. Being almost 44 myself, I realized I might not come into possession of the estate until I was nearly 75. A depressing thought. But I wasn't sad or frustrated. I simply started to think about leaving my wife for someone else. Which, in case you're even more damaged than I am and need it explained, is much worse. But that line of thinking is incongruous with my emotional attachment to the people involved. I love my wife madly and deeply, with gusto and delight. Aside from some purely instinctual animalistic urges that arise now and then, I'm free from conflict in my devotion to her and my commitment to our union. I've never been able to say anything so decisive about anyone before. I also love her parents. Ivone and Umberto are the kindest, most generous, most enjoyable non-English-speaking couple I've ever known. They are among the most enjoyable creatures I've known capable of any kind of speech. One of the great pleasures of life with Elisa is getting to know her family, as well as getting to know her home country and culture, though I've found some Italian customs baffling. The cultural habits that foreign travel has made me question the most, though, are those based here in the good old USA. All through my youth and even early adulthood, I lived under the false impression shared by many Americans that the United States of America is the best at everything and has the best, most advanced versions of everything. I've got news for you. It's not true. I think that's better known now than it was when I wrote these books. For instance, if you think the U.S. leads the world in cleanliness or availability of abundant produce, you haven't visited an Italian grocery store. My wife has said many times upon merely eyeing an American food shop, an Italian would never buy food from those people. In Italy, those people would be out of business. That was a response to a pretty decent place. I've seen the look on her parents' faces as they gazed into a New York delicatessen, horrified by the grime on the linoleum floor, the processed, prepackaged food products, and the yellowing, crusted fresh ones were secondary insults. But even before I had a chance to experience the lifestyles of my wife's Italian compatriots or to see their reactions to our cities, I learned about their collective fascination with us. The first evening I spent in the presence of Elisa's parents was on a trip we took for Christmas, only 2 months after we'd been dating. In spite of her Catholic background and upbringing, in spite of her parents' lifelong indoctrination to ancient small-town customs and habits, and in spite of our unmarried status, there was none of the drama that had accompanied my visits to the ancestral homes of previous girlfriends. Those earlier trips had all been surrounded by seemingly endless negotiations over who would sleep where. Delicate, roundabout discussions had to be held about how established a relationship needed to be before her parents, or even the girlfriend herself, felt comfortable enough for us to close the door to a room and share a bed. Neither Lisa nor her parents indulged in such postures. Her parents are working-class Catholics living in a tiny medieval town in northern Italy, but they possess a respect for their only daughter that lifts their sophistication beyond that of many cosmopolitan Americans. When I first met Umberto and Yvonne, Elisa's childhood room had been made up for the two of us, like a kiddie porn honeymoon suite. Two single beds had been pushed together and made up as one. The wall above the headboards was covered with framed photos of Elisa at 14, 15, and 16 years of age. Across the room were posters of Peter Sellers and Jerry Lewis that had hung there since she put them up when she was a teenager. Though many now think I've ended up with a woman as beautiful as my wife because I work in film and television, the truth is that Elisa thinks Jerry Lewis, circa 1965, is the sexiest man she's ever seen. He was gorgeous, she says. In her childhood bedroom, I looked at the poster of the Jewish clown grinning like an idiot. It's an odd fetish she's got, I thought, but I'm happy to reap the benefits. Later, while making love in the room she'd slept in since she was a little girl, I told Elisa how nice it was of her parents to allow me to defile her in her childhood bed. What does this word mean? Elisa asked. I do not know this word, defile. It means to make dirty, I told her. Relieved of the need to focus our energies on the avoidance of sex between adult offspring, there was time to talk about other things. This talk consisted mostly of a lengthy list of questions from Elisa's father, mother, and brother, her mother's brother, his wife, and their three adult daughters, her parents' friend, and their children, and just about every other Italian I met, all translated by Elisa, about every detail of life in the United States. Only later would I learn the focus of the greatest amount of Italian inquiry into American life. In spite of differences in diet, health care, and diverging forms of government and jurisprudence, my wife's family and friends' deepest curiosity has to do with how Americans keep their asses clean. In the literal, as opposed to the figurative sense. Not that I have tremendous faith in my countrymen's hygienic fastidiousness, but I hadn't realized there was an issue, or how the issue had declared itself international. It turns out the intrigue isn't based on actual encounters, but on their awareness of the absence of that ubiquitous Italian household appliance. The bidet.
Yeah.
I'd always thought it was the French who most adored bidets. To judge by my wife's family and their friends, the Italians are generally not enamored of their froggy neighbors. But it turns out the bidet is an essential item in every respectable Italian household. The question on a lot of Italians' minds is how Americans can consider themselves respectable or merely clean without washing their asses thoroughly after each and every bowel movement. How do you do it here, my wife asked early in our relationship. Does everyone take a shower every time they go to the bathroom? I know they don't, but I didn't see how I could admit it. I felt myself a member of a stinking, feces-ridden meeting. I'm not sure I can come up with an explanation. I've tried. I've offered arguments. Firstly, that our toilet paper is better than theirs. It's softer and more absorbent. Or, and this I was reluctant to ask since it's so graphic and potentially disgusting, it really depends, doesn't it, on the specific nature of each particular bowel movement? But no matter what I say or no matter what I think but don't say, in the final analysis, there's no question at all. No matter what the explanation or rationalization, no matter what my country's reputation for gleaming indoor plumbing and access to hot water and scented soaps, she's right. Washing is cleaner than not washing. You can talk about how Europeans don't shower as often as we do, and they don't. You can talk about their use of deodorant being more parsimonious than ours, and it is. But no matter where the line is drawn or where your particular sympathies line up, one fact is crystal clear and hard as the hardest stone. Their asses are cleaner than ours. It's as simple as that. I was talking this over on the phone recently with my parents, who had removed a bidet from their new house in order to enlarge the shower, and got some confirmation. Washing five times a day is cleaner than washing once, my father said. This is the same father who drinks a fiber-fortified cocktail each day to help with the regularity he claims to rarely enjoy. Judging from his five times a day comment, perhaps his aspirations for evacuations are unrealistically high. But it doesn't matter, he went on. I don't like the bidet. It tickles. No, you use your hand, instructed my wife, who'd been listening in on an extension. You don't let the water hit you. You take the water in your hand and then you wash. Silence. I thought their asses might be cleaner, but their hands should be. Then I decided to offer a joke. The real Italian way to do it is the most effective, I said. You clean and moisturize together by using a slice of prosciutto. Everyone laughed, but my wife's eyes grew wide and she said, that's not a bad idea. Weeks later, Elisa and I were watching an episode of a television show. The scene featured one rendition of a classic American TV joke, capitalizing on the sound of a toilet flushing. Immediately after, the husband appears and says goodnight to his wife. You see, Elisa said, that man is going to bed and he didn't wash his ass. Shame on him. Shame on us all. It's not only television characters that have disgusted my wife. Elisa related an incident that had horrified her on a business trip, during which she'd been forced to share a queen-size hotel bed with a colleague. She used the bathroom before coming to bed, Elisa told me. You could tell. I don't want to be disgusting, but you know, with sounds and the smell. And she didn't take a shower. She just came out and got into bed next to me. Elisa shuddered at the memory. I don't understand how you can do that. Maybe if you're in the woods, if we were in a tent, okay. When forced to, my industrious wife has even learned to take matters into her own hands. Prior to her confrontation with American realities, Elisa studied for a year in London. There she'd been forced to improvise in another supposedly advanced but unwashed country. We didn't have any bidets in the dormitory there either, Elisa said, so I would wash my ass in the sink. Those nasty English get what they deserve. Cultural divergences abound. Elisa and every Italian I've ever spoken with is horrified by the way American politicians speak about God and plead with him to bless our nation. God bless the United States of America comes out of our television set when a president speaks, and Elisa's head snaps as if she's been struck. What did he say, she asks? If the Prime Minister of Italy said anything like that, he'd be laughed off the stage. You talk about God and you'd never get elected to anything. You talk about what you're going to do about taxes, and then you shut up. God bless the Republic of Italy, I say. It's not the differences in our backgrounds that most fascinate me, though. It's the inconsistencies and the seeming contradictions, the distance between reputations and realities. And somewhat later in our relationship, I was startled by Elisa made at a high-end Italian design store in Manhattan. We were admiring various items from cocktail mixing sets to serving bowls, lamps, and furniture. When we came upon the ironing boards, Elisa's eyes grew wide and sparkled in a way I thought only I was capable of causing. She admired the heavy-duty, beautifully designed contraptions and said, if you ever want to buy me something, you could buy me this. I was taken aback. I grew up with a mother who'd gone back to college and gotten a master's degree in the late 1960s, before the women's movement had made such endeavors mainstream. Back when the local bank manager wouldn't allow her to open an account without her husband's signature and permission. In my household, there was a lot of talk about how disgraceful, inappropriate, and disrespectful it was to give a woman a gift whose purpose was to perform household chores. An iron, ironing board, vacuum cleaner, you'd be killed. Worse than killed, you'd live in torment the rest of your days. The woman who'd already agreed to be my wife was saying she'd like an ironing board for her birthday. Not just any ironing board, a $350 one. An ironing board that resembled scaffolding for a major construction site. Elisa's not a homemaker with no life outside of pleasing her husband through housework. She's a medical researcher who goes to a laboratory every day to investigate how the parathyroid hormone affects osteoblastic gene expression. She's not an American cliche. She is, though, an Italian cliché. She's an Italian cliché in that she will not leave the house with unironed clothes. It's not done. You don't have anyone over to dinner without an iron tablecloth. You don't even go to bed without iron sheets. Consider all the differences between us: nationality, language, religion, culture, upbringing. It's the enthusiasm for ironing that sets us apart. Well, that and my dirty ass. My wife claims she loves to iron, though I suspect it's the result she loves and not the activity. But I did not give her the ironing board for her birthday. Even if Eliza would be perfectly pleased with the gift, I'll never give it out of fear of what my mother might do to me. The only circumstance that could alter my position would be if, by some miracle, Eliza and I could afford a house of our own. Well, things have changed since then. We still don't own one, but we could, I suppose. I don't mean to plead poverty. There are plenty of places in the world where we could afford to have a home of grand proportions. They just don't happen to be in an area where I can be employed on a network television show, or where Eliza can work on a Fourier transform infrared imaging spectrometer. So we're stuck. But if there were to be a house somewhere in our future, I'd give Eliza the gift she craves, the one that might make her feel at home in this strange and anything but superior land. It wouldn't be the house itself, but buried in one of its smaller rooms, wrapped in colorful paper and decorated with ribbons, would be her first American bidet. Better yet, dueling his and hers models. Better still, one in every bathroom of the house in case her mother or father come to visit. Maybe we'd put one on the front porch to make sure no one enters. Forget wiping your feet. Wash your ass before you go. There we'd be, the most sanitized, well-ironed family on the block. Now, if only I could get those delis and grocery stores to clean themselves up. Or even a fraction of the population to stop, clear their heads of the propaganda they've been force-fed since birth, to resist the urge to berate others while aggrandizing themselves, or to sit down and carefully, tenderly, with or without a washcloth or pre-moistened baby wipe, or even any prosciutto, make sure their asses are as clean as they think they are, or as clean as they might be.
I don't want to take time with questions and answers because I want you to have time to talk to them personally, take some pictures, buy books and CDs. But I just want to ask Evan one question. Between Time on Fire and It's Only Temporary, how long was it until you found that gratitude and until you found that sense of humor?
Time on Fire is a very funny book, so I need to come up with a more uproarious passage. So the sense of humor was there, but I don't think I realized how angry I came out of that experience until years later, looking back. 6 degrees of Separation was the first thing I did back, and there were the parents in the cast and the kids, and the kids were all around 30 years old, and everyone was single and doing stuff together. And in looking back, I think it's pretty clear that a lot of people looked at me and were thinking, what the hell happened to this guy to make him the way he is? But I don't think I knew what I was until much later.
Did something bring that realization? Was there a moment?
I'm embarrassed to say some of it, but I mean, part of it was meeting my wife, for sure. You know, I didn't get married. My first marriage at 43, my first kid at 46. It's not like incredible or anything, but it was late. I was the last bachelor standing, I don't think it could have succeeded at the day sooner, but that really showed me that there was something there for me, that I could accomplish something I wanted to accomplish. That's the biggest part. I mean, honestly and truly, I think getting professional recognition was very meaningful to me, you know, on a wider scale. So it gave me the sense that I wasn't, my life wasn't going to end before I had achieved some of my goals.
Amen.
Beautiful.